Welcome to Home Networking 101. This is the ultimate guide for beginners who are looking to unlock the full potential of their home networks. Whether you're looking to make the most out of some new equipment that you just purchased from your local big box store, or you're eager to delve into networking best practices and security, you've come to the right place. This series is designed to demystify the world of computer networking and provide you with the tools to configure a best practice and secure environment for your smartphones, computers, and other devices. So hang on to your Ethernet cables as we dive into the first episode of Home Networking 101. The learning curve of home networking requires time and patience, but you don't have to go at it alone. I am proud to introduce Rogue Support, where we're supporting the unsupported with expert, independent network technicians who are ready to take on your networking challenges. At Rogue Support, we understand that even the best tutorials may not cover every networking scenario, and sometimes you need to call on the troubleshooting expertise of professionals. Each Rogue Support technician is handpicked by yours truly to provide you with the tailored assistance that you need. So whether you're grappling with frustrating Wi-Fi signal issues, looking to set up a secure network for your guests or IoT devices, or simply seeking to optimize your network performance, Rogue Support is just a click away with personalized on-demand support services. So say goodbye to the frustration of trying to navigate network problems alone. Visit us on the web at rogue.support or click the link in the description below to connect with one of our friendly rogues. With Rogue Support, you're just a few clicks away from conquering your network challenges and enjoying a secure and reliable home network. Computer networking at its most basic is the ability for two devices to communicate with each other. If you have two computers that are connected with an Ethernet cable and configured to share files or music or pictures of cats with each other, that's a network. Now, imagine being able to share those same files, music, or pictures with cats with every computer in the world. Well, now you've invented the internet. So let's take a step back and think of networking in terms of your own neighborhood. In your neighborhood, you've got houses, apartments, you've got stores, a post office. Think of each of these different entities as endpoints that are all connected to each other by roads, intersections, and highways. So in this analogy, the houses and stores and buildings are all devices. Could be a computer, a laptop, your smartphone. Now, when you go visit Amazon.com to do some shopping, that's basically the same thing as driving down the road to visit your local grocery store. But instead of traveling down the road in a car or bicycle, it's your data and information traveling out to the internet and then going through many different networks between point A and point B. Websites are simply computers somewhere out in the world that are specifically designed to respond to your requests and deliver you the information that you're seeking. So how does your computer know to share files with another computer in your house, let alone some unknown server running a website out there on the internet? Well, every single device on a network has a unique identifier, which is known as an IP address. It's a very similar concept to how the post office delivers mail to your home. When you send a letter to someone, how does it get delivered, right? It's because you've written the destination address on that letter with a street name, number, city, state, postal code. IP addresses are like the digital equivalent of house numbers in a digital neighborhood. Using that same concept, what do you put in an envelope that you're mailing to someone? You put in a letter, right? Which is some data. In the real world, your letter gets delivered to the destination address, but in the digital world, your data gets delivered to the destination IP address. Now, whether that data needs to be delivered to a computer in the next room or to a website on the other side of the planet, the concept is the same. These digital IP addresses and highways are what allow us to send emails, stream music and movies, video chat with our grandparents, and so much more. It makes this world seem a lot bigger and a lot smaller at the same time. So then why is it important to have a well-designed home network? Well, there's going to be many reasons for that, but to me, it boils down to one simple thing. If you're having to think about your network, then it isn't working properly. What do I mean by that? Well, when you have websites loading slowly, or you can't get Wi-Fi in the upstairs bathroom, or you can't stream your favorite YouTube channel, Crosstalk Solutions, from your phone to the TV, so that your significant other complains about you watching that computer guy again. Well, these are all examples of a network that isn't working reliably. and you're having to think about it, right? Your network should function so seamlessly that you never have to think about it. It's like the plumbing in your home, right? When you use the sink or take a shower or flush the toilet and everything's working fine, you don't give it a second thought. But when the toilet backs up or the shower fills up with, 2 inches of water, you've got a problem that needs to be fixed. But it also goes beyond reliability, right? A well-designed network means that you're gonna get optimal performance out of your internet connection. I mean, after all, you're paying for a certain internet speed. You may as well make sure that you're maxing it out. When Netflix is buffering or you're losing online games because you're lagging, you've got a network that needs to be optimized for performance. A well-designed network also takes into account security concerns. Your private data and devices should not be exposed out to the big bad internet, just like you wouldn't want to leave your front door unlocked at your house. Safeguarding your network and connected devices is crucial in this era where online threats, identity theft, malware, these are all serious issues. We're definitely going to spend a lot of time talking about securities and firewalls in this series. Finally, a well-designed network is future-proof. Now, 10 years ago, I never thought that I'd be controlling my robot vacuum with my smartphone, right? But here we are. And who knows where we're going to be in the next 10 years. By investing some time and effort into your home network, you're going to pave the way for a reliable, high-performing, secure, and future-proof digital environment. Now, let's dig into the basic components of a computer network that you're likely to run into as you design your own system. There are 4 main components to any home network: the modem, the router firewall, network switches, and wireless access points. Now, we're going to dig deeper into each one of these components individually later on in the tutorial series, but let's do a brief overview just to get started. The first device you should be aware of is the modem. When you sign up for internet service from an ISP or internet service provider, whether that connection is fiber internet, cable, DSL, or even satellite internet such as Starlink, the ISP has to give you that connection so that you can use it somehow, right? And typically the piece of equipment that they give you to hand off that connection is a modem. At its most basic, the modem is the bridge between your home network and the internet service provider. The next piece of equipment you'll typically see is a router or firewall. Now, technically speaking, a router and firewall are actually 2 different things, but they can also be used pretty interchangeably. A router is simply a device that routes traffic from one network to another, just like driving through an interchange that takes you from one highway to another. The router is that interchange, right? It knows about all of the networks that are connected to it, and it can send your data one way or the other, depending on the destination. Most often with home networks, the router is the device that routes private traffic in your home network, also known as a LAN or local area network, into the internet or public network, which is also known as the WAN or wide area network. Lots of times when you buy a router, it will have ports on the back labeled WAN and LAN. That's what these mean. LAN is your private internal network, and WAN is the internet connection or public network. As I said earlier, a router and a firewall are 2 separate things, but they can be used fairly interchangeably. If a router is like the interchange between 2 different highways, you can think of the firewall as a checkpoint on a highway between 2 different countries, right? So here in the US, if I want to drive up to Canada, I can't just drive through without stopping. There's a checkpoint that I have to pass through. At that checkpoint, they're going to see if I'm allowed to enter Canada, right? If all my paperwork's good and I've got an up-to-date passport, then I am allowed through. But if I fail these requirements, I am turned away and not allowed to enter the country. That's what a firewall is, right? It's a device that has a set of rules for which traffic can and can't enter a particular network. When I say that a router and firewall can be used interchangeably, this is because quite often in home networking, the router is managing the connection between your internal private networks and the internet. And that router has firewall rules in place by default that are designed to prevent unauthorized traffic from getting into your private network. So while a router can technically only be used to pass network traffic between networks without actually scrutinizing anything, a firewall is a router that has at least some basic rules set up for which traffic can pass between networks. The next piece of equipment that you are likely to encounter is a network switch, or just switch for short. So a switch at its most basic is a device that expands the number of ports available to plug wired devices into. A port is the connection on a network switch where you plug in an Ethernet cable. So any device that has an Ethernet connection, such as your computer, your smart television, your Xbox, PlayStation, or like this Roku right here, can be connected to the switch with an Ethernet cable. You plug one end of the cable into your device and you plug the other end of the cable into the network switch. When you run out of switch ports, you can simply add another network switch to the network, or you can buy a new network switch that has more ports available. Network switches can be very simple devices, but they can also be pretty smart, and we're going to be discussing network switches and what they can do a lot over the course of this tutorial series. But for now, just understand that switches are mainly used to connect wired devices so that they can share data with each other. Let's now talk about wireless access points, or APs for short. So APs are devices that are designed to connect wireless devices to your network. They're kind of like network switches, but rather than using an Ethernet cable to connect a computer to the network, you're connecting that computer wirelessly. More and more devices these days use wireless, which is also called Wi-Fi, to connect to the network. Your smartphone, tablets, laptops, and many different smart devices like your robot vacuum, smart switches, and smart light bulbs communicate wirelessly with an access point, which is then connected to the network itself, usually with an Ethernet cable, or integrated into a combination device. Now, in this series, we're gonna dedicate a full video to wireless technology and how to optimize the Wi-Fi in your home for the best performance. Speaking of combo devices, here's one of the key takeaways for this first intro to home networking. In this video, I'm discussing each of the core components of a home network individually, but quite often, you will have two or more of these core components combined into a single device. But understanding them individually is paramount to understanding the role that any device is playing in your home network. One more thing that I should mention that you're definitely going to run into is Ethernet cables. So Ethernet cables are used to connect network devices together, such as connecting your router to the wireless access point or your computer to a switch. Ethernet cables have what's known as an RJ45 connector on each end. The most common type of cable these days is called a Cat 6 or Category 6 cable. You can always tell the type of cable because it will be written along the cable. Usually it'll say Cat 5E or Cat 6 or something like that. Cat 6 cables are rated for gigabit or higher speeds and can be a maximum of 100 meters or 328 feet long. Although, honestly, it's unlikely that you'll actually ever see a cable that long. Now, the important thing to know is that if you need to buy some network cables, make sure they're Cat 6 or higher. So these are the main components of a home network: the modem, the router and firewall, network switches, and wireless access points. As long as you understand the role of each of these components, you're going to be much better equipped to head out to your local big box store and buy some equipment, because the options can be quite overwhelming, especially when you get into, you know, combo devices such as this Netgear AX1600. But we're going to save all of that for an upcoming video. In our next video, we're going to dive into everything that you need to know about different types of internet connections. Make sure you like this video if you learned something new, and subscribe to Crosstalk Solutions so that you don't miss out on the rest of this tutorial series. And if you'd like to keep this party going, I have hand-selected two videos on the right here for you to watch next. The top video is about my time spent with the ITDRC, helping with Hurricane Ian disaster relief. The ITDRC is an organization who uses their computer networking skills to help people in need recover from disasters. And the bottom video is my recent review of T-Mobile 5G wireless home internet.